welcome back to another episode of Jedi Council Collider. Jedi Council. We are representing David Griffin today, his wonderful hello. And I am Christian Harloff, a.k.a. Darth Harloff. And you guessed it, this is our Star Wars show. Everything in the world of Star Wars, we talk about it here on Collider Jedi Council. And we've got a pretty great council today. Last week, it was just me and this guy. It's Obi-John Kenobi. John Campia, what's up?
So many good things to talk about today. I'm very stoked.
You really are. Yeah. And she's back again. It's the Smith Lord.
I'm back.
Tiffany Smith.
Yay!
Mark Ellis, Mark2D2, did not want to miss today's show. He had an emergency that he
I really thought you were going to say didn't want to make today's show.
No,
and I was like,
he told me today he was bummed because he's missed the last like three. And he's like, I got to make it today, even if I got
to
be
in specific words to me were, screw the fans.
Yeah.
But you could feel the love when I said it.
He was like, he was force choking the fans.
Yeah, exactly.
No, we joke. Ellis will hopefully be back next week. Actually, no, he's out of town next week, too, the hump. So in 2 weeks, Ellis will be back. But he will be back on the council. He's not
Ellis
going
has been frozen in carbonite for the next couple of weeks.
Can you imagine? Even if he was in carbonite, he'd still be telling jokes.
Yeah.
Okay, true. So we're going to get to the first part of the show. If you're brand new to the show, the way it works, it is called simply Star Wars Movie News. Everything happening in the world of the movie news. It could be any of the anthology or Star Wars stories, whatever they're called now, as well as the saga films, episodes 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Who knows if they're happening? We'll talk about them. Tiffany, what is happening first?
So our first piece of info is that the Han Solo movie gets a May 2018 release date. And this is the second film that has gotten a move of release date. It's been toss-ups between May and December for all of the films. But this one, for me, I think it's just exciting because I'm like, okay, we're sticking to May and December for the actual episodes. And then for the anthologies or story films, it'll be the other date. How do you feel about this one?
Well, I mean, the fact that it comes out in 2019 is cool.
18.
This is 19, isn't it?
I think 18.
Oh, no, 18. You're right. This is 2018. Episode 9 is 2019.
Yes.
So 17 is episode 8. So this means that when we were supposed to get a Star Wars movie 6 months after, we were supposed to get episode 8 originally 6 months after Rogue One. Now it's going to be Han Solo 6 months after episode 8. And I'll tell you what, I kind of hope it gets moved to December. Because I love the idea of being nostalgic to the Star Wars May date, but with episode 7 and now episode 8 and Rogue One, it seems like December is the new Star Wars home. I kind of like that it's in December. Am I going to complain that I have to wait 6 months as opposed to a year to see another Star Wars film? No, but I kind of like them sticking to owning December because you see, and we'll talk about it in a little bit, you see what happens when they're in December, everybody gets the hell out of the way. Mm-hmm. So for me, I am okay either way, but how do you feel about it?
I think that I really like the idea of it being an episode in December and then the anthologies or Star Wars stories in May. I think that it just based off of this first film coming out, 6 months is like nothing.
Right.
We're still talking about The Force Awakens, and I think we will be for a little while.
Yeah.
That if there was another film that came out right on top of that, I would feel like it's a little bit too soon. So I like the fact that they're taking a little bit more separation between the films.
But don't you think that by that, Meredith, shouldn't they move it again to December? Because it'll only be 6 months between episode 8 and Han Solo.
But it's still a year between December to December for the episodes, which that's okay for me.
Okay, but you're okay with a separate story. John?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's only a five-month wait. December to May is only a five-month wait.
Right.
So it shortens it up even more. I'm with you on this. I'm like, if you're going to, you just moved one movie in December, why not just make that something we can set our watches to? December is Star Wars month. December, we know it's coming. Now, however, let me throw out one little possibility to you. This might make you happy.
Yeah.
Could it be that Star Wars wants to start establishing not just December as Star Wars month, but May as Star Wars month as well?
And
we are heading towards a possibility of two. I still don't think they're going to do 2 a year, but if they're doing this, like, maybe they're trying to get it in everybody's heads. May and December are both going to be Star Wars months because within 3 or 4 years, we're putting out 2 Star Wars films a year.
Great point. I wouldn't hate it. I've been calling for 2 Star Wars movies a year for a long time, and I think that the reason why, and nobody right now, most people are going to say, no, that's too much. Yeah, it's way too much. But I think you're not going to really know or have a decision until I think they'll start talking about it more as a possibility once Rogue One comes out, because we'll see how this anthology or standalone film does by itself. And who knows? Will there be a will these characters from Rogue One have a sequel if it's successful? Probably not. I would tend to say no. It's probably a one-off, but you never know. If some character really pops and they want to see another movie from him, then if they want, if that movie, like let's say something like Deadpool, right? Deadpool comes out, it crushes. It's going to do so well, and they already greenlit a sequel. If Rogue One does so well and people really respond to these characters like they didn't think, and then they want to do a sequel, they're now going to have to wait until 2020 before they can put a sequel out. And that might be a little too late. So I can understand the reasoning why this might happen. So it's a great point.
I mean, I think it totally opens it up too that, like you said, if the one film does really well, then it's like we can have the anthology films even closer to each other, mm-hmm. instead of having to wait a whole year where it's like, okay, maybe they're taking a little bit of a break for, mm-hmm. say, the episodic ones. And they're like, well, now we can do kind of a trilogy or a sequel for one of the yeah. anthology films back to back. Which yeah. I think opens it up to some cool stuff that they could do depending on what people enjoy.
Because listen, if Han Solo, the young Han Solo movie works, you think they're going to do just one Han Solo movie if it
no,
really
it's
works?
Like and people Guardians of the Galaxy, Indiana Jones, like if those are successful, they'll just keep building on it.
Because look, the thing is, and I'm with you, man, I don't necessarily think we need a Han Solo, young Han Solo movie. I just don't think we have it. But if Lord Miller, who we're both huge fans of, if they deliver and it's a movie that you are just, you walk out the same way that you did for Deadpool.
Right.
You're going to want a second movie if it's done in a way that it's that the story serves it, not just to make it, but if it's like, okay, there's more stories to tell with Han Solo. I was, you know, who knows? They're going to make it if the story, you know, is if it's ripe for storytelling.
Yeah, but I think there's also something to be said about putting too much backstory into a character that yeah, we already know and
I don't
love. And
that.
I'm already not thrilled with the idea that they're doing a Han Solo movie, but obviously, I mean, I'm going to be first in line and be there to see it opening night, obviously. So I really don't like the idea of them now, let's start piling more in there. And pretty soon you're going to start to have to retcon stuff to make room for these new stories with this one character. And like you were saying, there are so many other stories to tell other than just Han Solo. So I kind of hope they don't, but money talks.
Yeah.
If Han Solo comes out and makes $1 billion and gets an audience rating 75%, critic rating 80%, Disney's going to be right back into the books of how do we make another one then? And yeah, it's unfortunate.
All right. What's next?
So our next one is that Bob Iger announced that Rogue One is nearly done and they are moving on and starting to film. No, not moving on, but starting to film episode 8 right now. And just reporting like how great Disney's been doing fiscally.
Yeah.
When you talk about money, it's like obviously Star Wars is helping them so much. And this was the biggest thing that stood out for me was that it was, you know, they bought Lucasfilm for $4 billion and it's already up to $10 billion. So the money has made itself back. And how do you feel, Christian?
It's funny that you said that because I just went to Disneyland not too long ago. Awkward to drink with the hat. So when I went there, I was talking to my wife as we were waiting online. My daughter saw Chewbacca and was talking to him in Wookiee, which was amazing.
Yeah.
But I'm saying this was such a steal for 4.4, because I was online, and not only did I buy this, I bought the little, they have like a BB-8 cup as well,
yep.
too. They were like $14 a pop for these things. I'm online, and it was a line, and people were just, and I was only on the line for 15 minutes, and everyone was on that line buying it for $15 a pop. That's for one day, for the amount of people that are buying just that bit of merchandise, plus all the other stuff that's flying, lightsabers all over the park.
Yeah,
the parks alone, from the amount of money that they're bringing in, and then you know the comics and the novels and everything, $4.4 billion. They've already made $10 billion within 3 years of the sale
off one movie.
It's insane. So yeah, that definitely sticks out to me. And the fact that Rogue One is almost done, I think, also goes back to the rumors that they're doing some reshoots to fill in Han Solo. Like they're saying they're going to have a cameo from Han Solo mm-hmm. in this movie. Whoever he is, whoever they cast, that's why they're cast. That's why everyone's been asking.
To get pushed up.
So yeah, but I remember the casting rumors for Han Solo. Like, why are they? It's so early in the process. Why are they announcing it? This apparently is the reason why. So the things that stood out to me was that, and the fact we knew Episode 8 was going to be starting soon. It was already supposed to start about a month ago. Good news that they started. It looks like they kind of moved around that union thing. So I'm happy about it.
Yeah, I mean, the movie's less than 2 years away. So, like, you want to get into the filming. That the fact that Rogue One is almost done is very exciting. But when you look at the calendar, it makes sense. Because once that thing is done filming, don't confuse with being done filming with being done.
Yeah.
There's a whole new world of work that gets started once they say cut for the last time. There's a lot of stuff to do. So it makes sense. With the Han Solo thing, I firmly believe he's already cast. I believe he's cast. Yeah. I believe he's been cast for at least 3 weeks. I believe they know who he is. I believe there are going to be some new fake stories that come out over the next month or two about, now we're down to the final five. Yeah. No, you cast him already. I think they know who he is. And I believe you're absolutely right. I believe you're going to probably see a cameo, small, but a cameo, and it's going to be that actor. And they're going to start, because I think Lucasfilm understands actors are interchangeable. But some characters are forever associated with certain actors. Right. Han Solo and Harrison Ford. So I believe Lucasfilm and Disney are probably smart enough to know we need a little bit of time to acclimate our audience to, hey, this is Han Solo now. And a quick little cameo in Rogue One is probably a good way to start that off.
Yeah. Tiff, are you shocked at all that episode 8 has already started filming?
No, not at all. Because I think, you know, based off of what John said, and now the fact that, you know, there is such an interconnected world, so giving them a little bit of room at the back end, if they need to change something, I want them to be able to do that. Yeah. Where it's like, okay, maybe they decided we're moving forward with this anthology film. Wouldn't it be nice if we could incorporate it in here so everything feels even more tied together? So I'm excited that they're already filming that. I genuinely think they already filmed stuff for 8 when they were filming 7, especially the stuff on Skellig Island. You know, right. I think that they were already getting stuff. And just based off the fact that Mark Hamill was on set so much, or seemed to be in England for so long, and what we saw in the movie was like, he could have been there for
He just
one
kept
day.
Blowing that scene. He just kept blowing that scene 3 months. I'll tell you what it is. I don't think they probably planned on shooting episode 8 for another 6 months or so, but I think Mark Hamill, who's looking great, by the way, I believe Mark Hamill probably went to Bob Iger and said, look, this diet sucks. I plan on being fat again by September. Yeah. So if you want skinny Luke, tough. Let's go now. Yeah. So
you better get a move on
it. Yeah, let's get moving.
All right, what's next?
So our next one is that we are going to get even more of Obi-Wan Kenobi. It's a rumor. Rumor that was first started by the gentleman sitting next to me. I love it because StarWarsNewsNet.com has great stories, but they also kind of jump off of stuff that we do here where Christian posts. So obviously it's a rumor that Ewan McGregor will be returning as Obi-Wan in episode 8. So I'm excited about this. The picture that they have here is probably the coolest thing ever.
It's the one I posted on my Instagram. I think they got it off my Instagram, and it's
which you can see down there in the bottom corner.
Yeah,
there.
Yeah, bottom left. It's amazing. So let me start off by saying this. I had been getting some messages from somebody who had sent me messages during the Force Awakens period, and said they knew people who were working on the film and had this and had that, and they gave me a lot of stuff for Force Awakens that I said I'm not gonna post this. I don't know how true this is gonna be. Everything that this guy had sent me through The Force Awakens turned out to be true. Recently sent me and said, look, talk to this person that said there are some serious conversations happening right now with Ewan McGregor about returning in episode 8. Now, the first thing I wrote, and if you see my tweet, I wrote grain of salt. You know, this, I'm just going off of past what I've heard in the past here. This, it looks like Ewan McGregor might be in talks to come back to play a Force Ghost in episode 8. Then Star Wars News Net had Jordan Mason came in, who said that back in December, towards the end of the month, he got word from his sources that Ewan McGregor's name had appeared on a costume fitting list over in the production offices. Mm-hmm. He was certainly intrigued by the idea, but no one was sure what project it was for. Rogue One was filming at the time, and it is not unheard of for actors to reprise their roles for other areas. Despite some things being unlikely, I couldn't definitively say what the fitting was for. So he sat on the news. So then, after he heard my tweet, he thought that this made sense. And I think that Jordan Mason comes from, I think it's Making Star Wars. I have to double check that. But anyway, Star Wars News Net posted this. The reason why I even thought that it's possible is because of the Rey vision. The fact that they had Ewan McGregor come in.
Even for one line.
For one line of, these are your first steps. The fact that Yoda's scene was cut, that they were going to have him do a scene, and that you and I pretty much guarantee that we thought he was going to be, Yoda was going to be in episode 8. I think it makes sense to have Ewan McGregor playing Obi-Wan and talking to Luke, because it ties together the 6 movies in a good way. But that's me. You hate this.
I don't hate it. No. I just know that I buy it. It's, yeah. The problem with rumors like these is that it's a rumor layered on top of another rumor and predicated on a third rumor on top of that. So let's follow the logic here. Unnamed source. Okay, flag right there. As no, oftentimes no, unnamed sources are totally legit.
Yeah. But we've been burned by them.
We have been. You and I, sir, have been burned.
We have been burned by them.
And
sources. In the Star Wars world too.
Yes. So unnamed source. Okay, right off there, it's a flag. So it's probably unnamed source says Ewan McGregor is going to cast fitting for a movie we don't even know the title for. So it's a rumor based on a speculation, based on a previous rumor. So I am not going to get excited about this. Look, they had Liam Neeson's voice in a prequel film. So the fact that they got in Ewan McGregor to do the voice of Obi-Wan Kenobi for one line, and then they didn't even use one part of the line that they did, and said, ah, scrap McGregor's thing. Let's just get the original Alec Guinness voice and let's cut the editing up so it's him. So you had Ewan McGregor there doing the voice, and you even took out part of that.
But Alec Guinness just says Rey.
I know, but still, you could have just had...
True.
So I don't necessarily think it speaks any more to the possibility of him showing up or not. I will say this, though. Yeah. I've always believed it's a decent possibility. I really do. I think Yoda... In my head, it's a foregone conclusion. I think Yoda's going to show up. Obi-Wan, I think there is a legitimate chance that he shows up, but these particular rumors do no more to make me believe it anymore.
Yeah, I get it. That's why I started the whole thing with grain of salt.
Well, and I think, you know, it's also based off the fact of he's going in, he's on a fitting list, but is it just for Disney? Because, I mean, he's also going in and working on some other Disney projects.
No, from what this person told me, it was specifically with Lucasfilm and Star Wars.
Okay. Because I feel like there's something to be said where it's like, obviously, yes, now we know that Daniel Craig was actually in part of Star Wars, but the fact that he was on set didn't necessarily mean that he was there to be doing that. So it's like, you hear somebody's around or popping by set, trying something on, looking at something. It's like, okay, yeah, again, grain of salt and see. I'm excited about it. I think it would be awesome. I think it would be super smart because... That's one of the characters, I think, from the prequels and as an actor that everyone wants to see get another shot at this character.
Yeah. And that's why I think it's going to happen.
Yeah.
I think it's going to happen because you watch him when he was on, it wasn't Kimmel, was it? I can't remember where it was Kimmel or Fallon, where he was talking about just going in there and voicing the lines and how much fun he had. And he was waiting for such a long time for them to call him. It's not like even Harrison Ford was like, I don't know if I want to do it again. He wants to do it.
Yeah.
But that's irrelevant. Ultimately, that's irrelevant. No.
I know. I'm not saying because he wants to do it, it's going to happen. I'm just saying.
It makes it a little bit easier.
It makes it a little easier for a guy that's very excited to come back to the role to approach him and get on the phone and negotiations. Now, again, we both know negotiations could mean, hey, I want $7 billion to be in this. I'm in talks. Okay, we're not going to give that to you. Okay, bye. That could be the start and the end of it all. But so anyway.
But here's the thing. At this point, Obi-Wan's either in the script or he's not.
True.
He's either in there or not. What I don't want Lucasfilm to do, because I, like anybody else, will get a really big kick out of seeing Ewan McGregor dressed up like Alan Guinness, like we see in this picture here. Mm-hmm. I'll get a big kick out of that. But what I don't want them to do is go, hey, you know, it's not part of our story, but let's shoehorn in an Obi-Wan appearance. I don't want them to do that.
But I don't think it would. I feel like it's the same thing when the Vader rumors came out and they ended up to be true. It's not shoehorning Vader in because he was part of the story. And I think the same thing would be true of Obi-Wan. If he comes back in some way, I don't feel like they would be like, let's just like try and shove him in because he was such a like integral part of the original film.
It's also why I trust in Rian Johnson. Because I think that Rian Johnson's not going to shoehorn anybody in. He's going to fit in the right characters. And I know, I think, and remember, there's also those rumors about Hayden Christensen coming back in episode 8 as well. So whether or not the three of them, if they go off the special edition, it's Hayden Christensen's ghost. So we'll see. Okay, what's next?
All right, so our next story is all about some details on the cutscenes from The Force Awakens. The editors, we've got, why am I blanking on what their names
are? Mary Jo Markey and Marianne Brandon.
We're talking about the two scenes that were cut out. They had a scene with Unkar Plot and Chewie, and there was a scene with Captain Phasma that was cut out as well, both of them being for... Well, the Phasma one they said was more that it didn't fit in with the story, and the Unkar Plot stuff they said it just didn't feel right for where they were in the story and the characters. How do you feel about hearing this stuff?
Well, the funny thing is one of those things are canon and one's not, because the Phasma thing is not in the book.
Mm-hmm.
The the as far as the plot thing goes, that is in the book. And Pablo Hidalgo,
Chewie rips it. Well, sorry, spoiler, guys, if you haven't read the book, but
yeah, it's his. He rips his arms out of his socket. Yeah. He comes back and he finds Rey. And I had tweeted out to Pablo Hidalgo and something along the lines of, "Well, in the book, seems like his arms were off. In canon, what's still?" He's like, something along the lines of, sure bet that is that he's armless or something.
I was hoping he just tweeted you back. Sure.
No. He wrote back with a definitive answer that it was a canon scene. So that's interesting that was the case, and because it also showed it said a lot about the novel.
Yeah.
It said a lot about the novel that Foster got the script, read the script. From everything that was in there before they cut anything out, that's the book that he wrote. So there's a lot of stuff in there that was in J.J. Abrams' original script. So how do you feel about it?
At first I was excited because I was like, oh, cool. That means there was a scene with Phasma that maybe she did something that really showed who this character could be. And then you read what the scene is and it was just like her sending ships off. And I was like,
right.
Like, I think it was worthless. It ended up being like, okay, I see why they cut those scenes out. I mean, I think the stuff that's a little bit more integral to the story, some of the stuff that actually ended up in the book, or even, you know, the stuff that we heard about, you know, Maz Kanata things that may or may not have been shot that didn't end up in the film. These weren't things that really affected the story. So to me, it's almost like, okay, I trust them that much more that they shot stuff. It probably took a long time to shoot the stuff with Chewie and Unkar because that's a lot of effects. And the fact that they're like, it's not adding to the story. It's not taking us anywhere we need to go. So we're going to get rid of it. I like hearing that stuff, that it's not just like, we shot this cool stuff. It's got to go in somewhere. Mm. I don't know what that voice was.
One of the important responsibilities of an editor is to make sure that the characters that we see on screen, the way they're cut together, communicates the essence of who that character is supposed to be. And when the editors for Star Wars Force Awakens sat down and they read over the character dossiers and say, Captain Phasma, a useless character who does absolutely nothing in our film, then that's their responsibility to make sure in the edit that she comes across just as that. Who cares?
Yeah.
If I had found out they cut out a Phasma scene that actually showed her freaking doing something, then awesome.
What about the other scene? What about the arm, the Unkar plot scene?
Yeah, I think it sounds cool. It would have been cool to see, but it also feels like it wasn't needed in the movie.
Right.
So it's kind of feels like that's because, look, for editors and directors working together, cutting scenes, Mel Gibson once said on his DVD commentary of Braveheart, and it's a really good analogy. He said, cutting out scenes in your edit room is like killing your own children.
Yeah.
Because you maybe spend 3 days on one scene getting the lighting just right with 40 extras and blah, blah, and then you realize,
can't make it.
Cut. And in 2 seconds, it's gone out of your movie. For them to make those types of decisions to tighten up their film, to give the audience a better viewing experience instead of what they wanted to see in it, I think that speaks volume about the type of care they've put in these Star Wars movies now.
It absolutely does. And what I will say, that I think that it also, for that scene with Unkar Plot, and when it really works well in the novel, it does. It takes you, whether it's the audiobook or when you're reading it, it works well. I agree that I think that it wouldn't have worked because at that point, where she is, Rey, and she's got to get to that vision.
Yeah.
And by just running into him, it throws it off. It doesn't take you out of it when you're reading it or listening to it, but I think it would take you out a little bit more.
Something to the vision scene,
right,
like her going through this first before getting there, okay, but it wasn't. It was just a bump on the road to get to the vision, and it probably wasn't needed.
It's going to say a lot about canon, though, too, in episode 8, if he comes back.
If he has arms, doesn't have arms,
that's going to be a conversation on this show.
You know, right?
That's going to be one of the main.
Because you know what I'll do if he has arms,
start sniffing around. Yeah, I know.
Smell that?
I know.
Multiple layers of candy.
But yeah, I think you'll also give it credit if it turns out that he only has one arm.
Yeah, totally.
We'll see what happens. Okay, what's next?
Our next one are the Disney first quarter reports, which may off the bat sound kind of boring, but it's kind of jumping off of what we talked about earlier, where Disney bought Lucasfilm for $4 billion. Now they've made $10 billion, and they're just talking about how much they've actually increased Their numbers are up 30%, and that's not just within film. That's in the resorts. That's in the park. So it's just crazy because you also kind of think about, I just finished reading How Star Wars Conquered the Universe.
Great, wasn't it?
It was amazing.
The best book ever.
But just hearing how Lucas knew that the products and, you know, all of that stuff was going to be such a big part of it. And now looking at this point where you're like, dang, Lucas is probably like, you guys should be so happy that I did all the things that I did.
He could have sold it for $8 billion. Yeah. He could have easily sold it for $8 billion. Now, he could have fought for it. I mean, because...
I don't think he needed to.
He didn't need to.
You know why? Because I think at the end of the day, his back-end deals on this, I think, are going to compensate way...
I think he owns 4% of Disney.
Is that what it is also?
I think that's what it said. I think it was he got $2 billion cash, and then I think he owns 4% of Disney.
Okay, I'm just saying for asking price, though, if he wanted to... He could have, but you're right. He made other deals that are going to make him.
He's making
and his
money
family
off this
and his grandkids and his great grandkids for the rest of their lives. But this thing is just a juggernaut because even going back to Disneyland when I was there last week, I'm on my way out of Disneyland, and at nighttime it starts to filter out a little bit. It was crowded, but not that bad until you get to around the Tomorrowland area and the Star Wars area, and it's just. You can't move. My wife was like, it's still so crowded over here. She's like, my daughter wanted Kylo Ren's lightsaber.
And you went on a weekday, didn't you?
I went on a Friday. Yeah. Friday.
Okay, yeah. Weekend it might have been a little day. Lighter if you
it was
went
lighter.
Like, yeah.
It was lighter, for sure. But it was packed during at all times of the day. Lightsabers and everything was coming out and Star Tours. And it was just watching, it was such a smart move because I can see why everything is going up. And Rogue One hasn't even come out. That's another, at least... Domestically, another $200-300 million here, definitely. It's a beast.
I mean, look, this was a coup d'etat. This was a definite win-win for everybody. And him, Lucas, I mean, in that book, How Star Wars Conquered the Universe, it goes into about why Disney to Lucas was the right place to go. That he actually trusted Disney. Because look, he was going to make... Three small nations.
Called them white slavers.
Yeah. He didn't call them white slavers. Let's clear that up. Now, before, I mean, he could have sold this thing to anybody and got the money he was asking for. But he trusted Disney. And he put in there. And this is where I think it also becomes key. The trust became key, not just because of his care for his property, but also because of those back end deals. So he could have sold it to Universal for $6 billion. Right. Mm-hmm. But in 10 years... He knew if I sell it to Disney for $4 billion plus a percentage of this, a little bit of ownership, I'm going to make a lot more money in the long run than doing it here. I think it speaks to how much foresight Bob Iger had. I think it speaks to how much foresight George Lucas had. This is a deal that just worked for everybody who was lucky enough to be involved.
Well, I think there's a quote in the book that says something like, if the world were to end, like the mouse at Disney would still be around, and he wanted to align himself with that with Star Wars.
Smart. Okay, what's next?
Our next story is Star Wars Episode 8 is set to dominate December 2007, and now another film has moved out of the way. Avatar 2 moved, but now Spielberg's Ready Player One has also moved out of the way of Star Wars.
Great image, by the way.
Back there. So cool. That's so good. I'm just going to say, if you haven't read Ready Player One, you totally should, because I'm really excited about that one, too. But how do you feel about this information? Do you think it's
a no-brainer?
Yeah.
You knew it was going to happen from the second we talked about it on Movie Talk. And it was Avatar was lined up. Ready Player One was lined up. And we were all like, they're going to get the hell out of the way. You just, after you saw what Force Awakens does, it's a smart business move. Like, I don't care what Avatar would have done, because Avatar would have done good business against Star Wars.
Not as good.
Not as good.
If it moved.
You got to get out of the way. And Ready Player One, Steven Spielberg, is also tightly lined with Disney. With Disney and Star Wars. So he probably got the call right away. And he's like, I'll announce it in a little bit, but we're not staying there.
Yep.
He knew that he had to move also. What, he's going to go up against Star Wars? He's going to be involved with Star Wars. Because, you know, whether or not he's being a consultant or whatever he's doing, he's been around. I mean, I think he was the one who helped get JJ on board for episode 7.
Yes, he was. Yep.
Well, so, and he was at the Kennedy Center Honors with George.
Yes. And he was at the premiere with George. Him and George stood together at the premiere.
I mean, no brainer, smart move for them to get out of the way. And this is another reason why I think Star Wars should just, whether, you know, going back, if it's just one film a year, I think that they should stick in December, because people do not want to be anywhere near them. And it's a good time to dominate and own January as well.
Well, and I think when you look at The Force Awakens and how it built and is still going, and how long it took for any other films to kind of creep their way back in. Mm-hmm. I think that that probably had a big effect, because it's like, say it, Force Awakens had come out and by January people were like, well, okay, I'm on to all the next stuff. Then I think that these films maybe wouldn't have wanted to get so far out of the way.
Right.
But based off of that, it's like, you don't want to be in the wake of Star Wars. You want to be like way after that shift has passed. It's,
well, it depends. It depends on what kind of movie you are. If you're an Avatar, or if you're like a sci-fi dystopian, whatever, if you're a Ready Player One, you want to stay out of Star Wars.
Right.
But
if you're Chipmunks 7.
Sisters.
Yeah, yeah.
Sisters made over $100 million opening on the same day as Star Wars. Will Smith's new film, Collateral Beauty, just moved to the Rogue One.
Counter-program.
Yeah, counter-program. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's, so it's not just about getting your movie out of the way. It's... if you're a certain type of movie, and if like the audiences that they're trying to appeal to with Ready Player One, those are the audiences that are also going to be really interested in Star Wars. Bad idea.
Yeah. Super bad idea. And Spielberg is one of the smartest guys in the business to know to get out of the way. And they'll maybe it becomes a summer movie the following year. I think that they did. They come up with a date when it's coming out yet?
I have not heard another date.
I don't think so, but it'll pop into the summertime sometime, and it makes sense. So, okay, what's next?
Our next story is about Kathleen Kennedy. She did an article with Vanity Fair, which Vanity Fair always is just breaking great articles with everybody involved in Star Wars. But just talking about storytelling, and I think the biggest thing that they talked about a lot is that she just wanted to emphasize that everything that they do is character-driven. What were some of the things that stood out for you reading this article?
It just goes back to the fact that she's the right person to be running the place right now. Like, you, from who she has already put on with the directors and the writers, and she's going after people who do that are great at developing stories and characters and tone. And that's what I got out of it. Just what she said, you know, to sit and talk ideas with Tony Kushner, to explore lots of different areas that we can go. It's a constant education. That to me is thrilling. And so the only thing I can try to do next is get Tony Kushner to write a Star Wars movie. Mm-hmm. There are times I think about that. So, you know, she just cares. She cares about, and she knows. She knows that she'll never say it, but she knows that the prequels to a lot of people, in regards to that, the story and the characters of, weren't developed the way that they were in the original trilogy. Mm-hmm. She knows that. She realized that a lot of people, the people who had problems with the trilogy, the prequel trilogy, had that problem. That they're just, who was the protagonist? What was their motivation? What? This is something that she makes sure that she's going to find out. The way she pitched it to JJ. Don't you want to know what's happened to Luke Skywalker? That's it. Yeah. Not, you get to make a Star Wars movie and big effects and just, no, what happened to Luke? What happened to this? You get to tell the story. She wants to tell the story. She's a storyteller.
Mm-hmm. I totally agree. I mean, I think that you look at the original films and it was, yes, there was a spectacle of it being in space and the Millennium Falcon and, you know, crazy things going on, but when it came down to it, it was really about these characters and their stories and their small stories and what was going on with them. And then you get the prequels, and it, if you just look at the prequels, like, the characters look amazing. Yeah. Amidala looks so cool with all her makeup and everything.
And the story itself is there.
Yeah,
it is,
but
there.
It's like, I can't tell you specific things about the characters. I can tell you, I guess, how they come into play in the story, but it's not like I know them as people or non-people, for the ones that are not human. So I think hearing her say this again, it is just like, she's the right person for the job. And we saw that come to fruition, even with The Force Awakens. You know, I think it was they said she was talking with someone initially about writing The Force Awakens, and they didn't want to put focus on the originals as much. They wanted to go straight into the new characters, and she was like,
Fincher, wasn't it? Fincher? I think it was Fincher.
But they decided no. They were like, we want to honor the past characters, the originals, and then move into those stories. And I think that is even saying something too. We want to honor these stories that were built before we just jump over to something else.
John?
Look, in the pantheon of iconic Hollywood gods, two of the giants will always be George Lucas and Steven Spielberg. And there's one person that they share that is probably the one person in Hollywood they would trust the most, and that's Kathleen Kennedy.
Yeah.
And more than that, Kathleen Kennedy and George Lucas knew that Kathleen Kennedy, I'm not going to say idolized, but really respects and loves George Lucas and what they've built with Star Wars and what they've done. for her to be the heir apparent, we've talked many times about what it was absolutely the right choice for her to be the heir apparent. But now we're seeing the fruit of that trust that was invested in her. We're seeing her say to screenwriters, no, we're not just going to abandon the past because that's the richness in which this whole universe dwells and abides. We're going to be, and for our audience, we need to stick with the past. Right. It shows in her selection of directors at the point. Mm-hmm. The very fact that you've got a Rian Johnson directing a Star Wars movie mm-hmm. is unbelievable. Yep. And I guarantee you it came from the mind of Kathleen Kennedy.
Oh, absolutely
Kennedy.
It did,
so
yeah.
You're seeing, we've known for a long time she's the right person, but now we're seeing it actually tangibly paying off yep. that her being in control of this thing, it was absolutely the right thing.
I agree.
Well, and I think it also takes somebody who would be willing to say no to George Lucas or yep. have him tell her something and her be like, okay, we're not going to do that. And be okay with that. Because, you know, the comparison that they did was that basically George Lucas is like her Yoda. And I'm like, yeah, Yoda taught things and then like stepped back.
Right.
And that's what I feel like the relationship with them is that he does respect her and he does listen to, like, agree with the things that she's doing, well, even if sometimes that means being like, no, George. Well,
but he now, even if he did want something to happen, he doesn't even really have a say.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, I agree with you. I think that it's always been that kind of teacher student thing with them. Yeah. And she's clearly learned a lot.
Yep.
All right. Last story.
And speaking of honoring the true story of Star Wars, John Williams just turned 84 years old. So great. I want that kind of cake for my birthday. But this is the man that created the sound of what Star Wars is for all of us. And, you know, getting him back with The Force Awakens, so exciting. Such a big year for him, I'm sure. What does this make you feel like?
I mean, you know, it's John Williams, the mm-hmm. most iconic. I'm a big scores and soundtracks guy. Scores, you know, obviously. And John Williams is the best of all time. There's no one that's going to touch him ever. He's still out there and he's crushing it. Like, it's funny because, and I don't know if Dennis, his opinion has changed, but I remember when I first saw The Force Awakens and I ran into Dennis and I said, you know, the one thing was the music. Like, it's John Williams, and I thought that the music was good, not great. And then I saw it again, and it just, the more and more you listen to it, mm-hmm. how powerful Rey's theme is. Rey's my favorite theme. And then Kylo Ren now, when you hear dun, 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 it's like, it's so, he knows how to set the tone yeah. for every, still at 84 years old, still he's got it. And you know, you always honor him. He's the best.
If you walk into any average person on the street and say, name the most memorable film scores of all time, what are you going to hear? Obviously, you're going to hear Star Wars. You're going to hear Indiana Jones. You're going to hear Stars. Jaws, I mean. You're going to hear Close Encounters of the Third Kind. You're going to hear Superman.
Right.
Dun, 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 dun. Yeah. All of them, same dude.
People forget that he did the original Harry Potter as well, too. So, yeah. And then, so John Williams, 84 years old, the best of all time. Okay.
Agreed.
Now, the next part of our show that we do every week here, simply known as, what's the deal with canon? Everything happening in the world of Star Wars, whether it's the books, the novels, the comic books, TV shows, anything that ultimately leads back into the timeline of the films, we talk about it. Tiffany, what's first?
So first up, Vader issue 15 came out, and I have not had a chance to read this one yet. So Christian, I will pass the comic book geekdom over to you.
Yeah, I just read it, and I will tell you that it's actually issue 16.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, this is the 15th one. I sent Ray the wrong one. It's issue 16 that just came out, and the 15 was the end of this whole run of Vader down. 16 basically starts, and it reminds me of that. It's like those cartoons you used to watch as a kid, and it's Saturday mornings, and it's just a brand new adventure, but it's a little darker. It opens up great because it's opening up to let you know that it's a brand new storyline that's going to happen, and it opens up with Palpatine, and there's a great dialogue with him and Palpatine sending him on his next mission. But man, the dialogue is written so well.
Yeah.
I heard Vader's voice and I heard the Emperor's voice when I was reading it. It was like, it was authentic. And that's what I look forward to in these comics. And so now that they put this queen in power, so the Empire could kind of have stake on this one planet, and Vader's over there to be kind of the liaison between her, and he's kind of bullying her a bit too. It's classic Vader. Nothing super big happens in the timeline except
the beginning of a new story.
It's the beginning of the new storyline. Yeah. So,
John, what did you think?
Oh, I didn't read
it. Yeah, hasn't read
but
all
I do have. Let me throw in one trivia question for you guys. How many Academy Award nominations did John Williams have?
18. No. 82.
No, it is not 82.
I was going to go 84.
18. One for each year of his life.
18.
It's not 18. I'll see which one of you gets closer.
20.
You are closer.
No.
He was nominated for 45 wow. Academy Awards, wow. winning 4 for best score, winning wow. 1 for best song.
He's only won twice?
Four for best score,
oh, four.
1 for best song.
Okay, so it's all
so five.
So he's five
it.
Oscars on his shelf, wow. nominated amazing. 45 times.
Amazing. Amazing. Okay, so that's Vader at number 16, not 15.
Yep.
And then now we go to something that we all have seen, and that is the latest episode of Star Wars Rebels. This episode was called The Call. Myself and David Griffin, hello! We reviewed this entire episode. Tiffany and John, you guys were not on the recap episode, so let's get your opinion on The Call, a.k.a. Space Whales. Tiffany, let's start with you.
I was doing my whale call.
That was very good. That was very good.
What did you think of Space Whales?
I felt like as soon as I heard the noises, I was like, they're space whales. Where are the space whales? And then they showed them. I thought it was a okay episode. Was not one of my favorites of Rebels. But I do think it also kind of made me feel like Star Trek with the whales.
Yeah, a lot of people save
the
that.
Whales.
Yeah.
And I think it was interesting because the more I think about it, the more I'm like, it was not one of my favorites because I feel like everyone was like, sure, whatever you say, Ezra, which doesn't normally happen on the episodes. So it was like, Ezra wants to go with the whales and they're like, okay, we'll trust you with the whales. I'm like, when was there all of a sudden this like changeover that you completely trust Ezra? He's still like the kid of the bunch. But I did think it was really cool the moment where he connected with them and you got to see that, like, just the interesting like artwork that they do where, you know, he could read their minds and they were speaking to him. That was cool.
John.
I think it's one of my five favorite episodes of the season
way!
So far. I actually really did. I was really... Now, look, I'm like everybody else. When we saw the space whales...
It was great. You watch our reaction video.
The space whales are cool.
When we did a reaction video and he screams out, he goes, space whales!
Are they seriously space whales?
Yeah.
I was not a big fan of these. Like, come on, space whales? Really? But there's something about it. And let me speak to the thing about Ezra for a second. I kind of felt like every time Ezra did get his way, there was an extenuating circumstance. Like, he already went down to the platform, right? And then he broke the plan. The plan was broken. And then Harold's like, why are we doing this? Well, you'll have to ask him because he already broke the plan. So I felt like they found their way around it. What I really enjoyed about it was they seemed to be establishing more and more and more that Ezra is one of these force users who does have a distinct connection with living creatures. We saw that in the episode with the plane cat. We saw that with those creatures that when he started touching into the dark side a bit. We see it now again with space whales. Even, you know, without his master being able to sense this stuff or touch into this stuff at the same time. So it was really cool, and it built on the mythology. The fact that you have these creatures that like actually fed on what we would consider fuel, and then that these are actually creatures, by the end you discover they actually can live in the realm of hyperspace itself, which is maybe part of the reason why you don't see them very often or have ever seen them in the Star Wars universe. So is it my favorite episode of the season? No. Is it my second favorite? No. But I'm going to say I think I put it in my top five. It was a nice little in-between episode for me.
I really enjoyed it too. And I'll tell you why also is because...
Why are we so negative?
Yeah, no. Space...
You're always so negative.
Now, why do you hate Anne Hathaway? Now, Exogorth.
Oh, gosh.
And Exogorth. Remember, they are, that is the creature that is in the asteroid in Empire Strikes Back.
Mm-hmm.
So if that thing can be living out in space, just middle in the middle of an asteroid, why can't space whales?
Yeah.
So the space whales, to me, I felt the exact same. We're going to do a whole episode about whales, but I thought it was because of the way, what it said about Ezra and what you and I have said continuously about this show. This show doesn't do filler. You think it does.
Yeah.
You think this show does filler, but then it always comes
into
play.
It does set
up. Yeah.
It always...
This episode felt like the one last season where they landed on the planet. I can't remember the title of it.
And it seemed like aliens.
And there were
right?
all those little
crates.
Like things.
Yeah,
the crates and stuff. And then it ends up coming back later in the season. I didn't think it was a terrible episode. I just feel like there was, I just didn't love it. Yeah. And I just felt like there was stuff that didn't necessarily fit the characters that I know.
It seems to be a love or hate, not a love or hate, but there are a lot of people out there who didn't like this episode. And I get it because you, especially when they showed you the trailer that they showed you for season 2.5, whatever it is. When they showed that, you thought you were going to get all this crazy information. I don't think that stuff that we saw with Darth Maul and all is really going to play into like the last three episodes, and then that's going to lead into season three. I think that's going to be what happens. But this was an episode to me that spoke a lot about Ezra and his tuning into how powerful he is in the Force. I think he's going to be more powerful than Kanan by a landslide.
Oh, yeah, completely.
And I still think he's going to the dark side. I know you don't, but you're on this. You think
he's, oh, he's halfway there already. Yeah, oh, yeah, so he's going dark.
Yeah. Okay, what's next?
Whatever.
By the way, next episode, we see a favorite of ours is making his next appearance. The next episode is Homecoming. We're going to see Cham.
We are going to see Cham Syndulla.
Syndulla.
Yeah, I got one of our fans was like, did you say Syndulla? I said, no, Syndulla. Cham Syndulla. So he is Hera's father and a big part of the great novel that we love, Lords of the Sith.
Yep.
And he's going to come
into
play.
Pretty much the main protagonist, really, of Lords of the Sith.
He is, and he's coming into play pretty soon. Speaking of which, Tiffany, what's next?
Our next story is that the last five titles of the Rebels season have been announced. First up, we've got Shroud of Darkness on March 2nd, The Forgotten Droid on March 16th, The Mystery of Chopper Base on March 23rd, and then we have a two-parter, Twilight of the Apprentice Part 1 and Twilight of the Apprentice Part 2 on March 30th.
This is why I'm going back to exactly what I said not 5 minutes ago, that all the stuff that we're going to get with that awesome trailer is going to come with Twilight of the Apprentice Part 1 and 2, mm-hmm. because I remember Dave Filoni saying Chopper's getting his own episode, and that mm-hmm. seems to be the Chopper base. Forgotten Droid, maybe that plays into something as well, too. And then Shroud of Darkness, I don't know which one that's going to be. I don't know. But Shroud of Darkness kind of seems like there's going to be more Vader maybe in that one. But that last two, Twilight of the Apprentice means see you later, Ahsoka. That's what that means to me.
Yep.
I mean, see you later.
I think so, too.
Yep.
Yeah.
And I've never been excited to see an episode with Ahsoka Tano in it. And I'm excited. I love the way they have used her.
What does that say about you that you're excited about the ones that she might die?
No. I'm saying, like, but what I'm saying is like, I think the way they've used her in Rebels has been great. And to the point where, look, if you're going to be a character, I believe you reserve the honor of being a character that has a pivotal role to play an entire season and then dies at the hands of Darth Vader, probably doing something heroic. That is an honor I want saved for one of my favorite characters.
Right.
I've always hated the Tano character, but I've liked the way they've used her in this, and I think this is actually going to be glorious. Mm-hmm. I think this is going to be glorious. I think this is going to be wonderful. I think it's going to pull at everybody's heartstrings. Yeah. I think it's going to be emotional. I think it's going to have impact on the...
On Ezra.
On mm-hmm. all the characters, yeah. on Ezra, on Kanan. I think it's going to have an impact on the rebellion itself. Mm-hmm. I think it's going to be great. Not a lot of people know that Chopper Base is actually Chopper's DJ name. That's what he does in the series. But other than that, Shroud of Darkness intrigues me.
It does, because I think that might be the episode, if it doesn't play into the Twilight one, but where Vader pops in and is talking to the...
I think it's the one where Maul drops
in.
Think
so? Maybe.
I think so.
That could be it. It
could be.
It could be it. Okay. So now we get to the part of the show where you guys chime in. Every week we ask you guys to go to Twitter and hashtag Collider Jedi Council. We go through them. We pick them out. Tiffany, what do they got?
Our first one is from Christian Barrera.
Great name.
What? Oh. Aside from Vader and Tarkin, who else do you think will pop up in Rogue One? Bail Organa, Mon Mothma?
I hope Bail Organa and Mon Mothma pop up. I think it's a nice way to tie it in. Like we said before, I think we're going to get a cameo from Han Solo for sure. But yeah, I'd like to. Those are the ones I'd like to see pop up. A young Wedge Antilles might be kind of cool too. Or not even young. I mean, it's not too far away. So Wedge Antilles would be awesome. But those are the ones, if any, that I would like to see.
I mean, obviously, I'm excited. I actually am really excited to see Han Solo. You talk about Wedge Antilles, and I'm like, I would be excited to see that as well. But I feel like we would have heard something about that person, like a younger version of that character being cast, because it's such a loved character.
Unless it's small. Unless it's like a smaller role, and it's like, you know, hey, who are you? Oh, Wedge. Oh, it was Wedge.
Private Antilles. Run over.
Yeah. John, do you care to see anybody from the original trilogy?
Well, here's the thing. We've said this about Rogue One before when it comes to Darth Vader. Unlike say in the prequels where they just shoehorned and forced us certain characters that didn't need to be there just because for recognition's sake. This is the formation of the rebellion. Bail Organa being there is organic.
Yeah.
Mon Mothma being there is organic. Darth Vader being there mm-hmm. is organic. This would be not just
they would be there.
Okay to yeah. do. He would be there. Yeah. It makes sense. It would almost be jarring if they weren't there. Yeah. So yeah, for those characters, totally buy
it. Will it be
that.
Jimmy Smits? Well, Jim,
nah.
You don't think Jimmy Smits will
come
back?
You gotta go a little, you gotta go younger. You have to get a younger version of him at this
point. Unless they can like Tron it up.
I mean, but it's only
Tron
been,
style.
I mean, it's only been what, 10 years since the, I mean, not really, because it's only been 10 years since Revenge of the Sith, right? So you add an extra 10 years to Jimmy Smits.
Well, it's no, been, it's, no, you're right. No, you're right. It actually isn't that far.
It actually, no, because,
that
could, because
in that case, I'll say yes, maybe
yeah,
Jimmy
because
Smits.
Because Bail Organa would be, I mean, you actually tack on in Star Wars years, like 15, 20 years from Revenge of the mm-hmm. Sith onto the Rogue One time. So I hope they use him. Now, Mon Mothma, obviously, got to get a different actress.
Yeah. But,
okay, next one.
Our next one is from Michael Brune, and he asks, Lando was in Empire. Does he get his cameo in episode 8? And what about The Force Unleashed for the next title?
I love the video game tie-in. I don't think it'll happen. I'd love them to do something like that. But, mm-hmm. I mean, they brought in Starkiller Base, and Starkiller, of course, has been part of the Star Wars family for a very long time, whether it's the character in Force Unleashed or the original name for Luke Skywalker. But in regards to Lando, yeah, I think we're going to get a Lando cameo. I want to see him on the Senate. I want to see him somewhere, maybe not even on the Senate, but maybe he's, you know, still doing his thing somewhere else. But I think we're going to get Lando.
I think it's absolute. Like, I was already kind of convinced it would be when they had that episode of him in Rebels and he actually did the voice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I became really convinced as we're walking down the red carpet, mm-hmm. the premiere, I was like, is that Billy Dee Williams?
Yeah.
And then when Billy Dee Williams, I was like, all right. And then he was actually interviewed on the carpet too. Mm-hmm. Said, can we see you again? He goes, you just might. I mean, like, so it's like, okay, yeah, we're going to see Billy Dee. We're going to see Lando. He probably won't be a major character. It's not.
No.
He's not going to be the replacement Han Solo that Han Solo was in The Force Awakens, but no, I'll be shocked if he doesn't cameo at least.
I mean, you got to give the head nod to Billy Dee.
Well, and I think, like we've said, it doesn't mean that they're 100% going to be in the movie when you see them on the carpet. But there was a lot of people tied to the Star Wars universe that didn't get invited to the premiere. Yep. And so you see him there. And yes, he was doing an interview with Star Wars. And so it's like, okay, they're probably trying to like creep him back into the world so everyone knows Billy Dee's still around and he's ready to play Lando. Yep. And along,
he looks good too.
Yeah, he does. And I think that along the lines of the title, I love the title, but again, I think it's the same thing. There was something that was actually successful with that title, so I don't think they want to confuse people like that.
Yeah, I actually don't like the title. I wouldn't.
Fortunately, I don't think. No. I think it'd be a nice. It would just be kind of fan service, and I don't really know. I mean, look, I don't know what the script's about, but
and a lot of the fans wouldn't even get it.
Right. True. So not necessary. Okay. What's next?
Our next one is from Dusty Pearson, who asks, since Disney has just started has just stated episode 9 is not the last Star Wars film they're making, do you think it'll have a more open ending?
It's a fantastic question because, you know, you got to start thinking about it. The first thing that I thought about was, well, if they're going to do episodes 10, 11, and 12, which you assume they will, they're going to have to announce that within the next 2-3 years, you would assume.
Not necessarily.
Well, the question then is, after episode, you're going to have episode, if they're doing it the same way.
If they're doing it the same way, then it has got to come out in 2021.
Yeah.
Which right now is only five years away.
Oh my God, that's
my point. So, like,
in 3 years, it's only 2 years away. It's got to be announced.
It's got to be announced within 2-3 years. So the, although what they could also do, if they don't make it open, if they just close it out, that's the end of this trilogy, mm-hmm. and then something else, like there's a new, this is another way that maybe you do stick to just that one film a year, and let's say again the Obi-Wan standalone movie comes out, mm-hmm. and they want to focus on the Obi-Wan trilogy or whatever the new movie is that they're going to do, and that will, it will hold that, but they said, oh, but episodes 10, 11, 12 will be coming out in 2023, 25 and 27. That could happen as well, too. So as far as it being open-ended, I don't think it will be. I think episode 9 will have a clear-cut ending to it, but then fast forward, those characters that we know are going to be locked in, like Finn and Rey and all that stuff.
Well, and I think I just keep looking at how Disney has worked with Marvel, where it's like, we don't have an official, like, every so often we know in this many years we're going to get an Avengers film. it happens when it happens. And then there's things like Captain America Winter Soldier, which feels like a mini Avengers film because there's so many of them in
Avengers 2.5.
Right. Yeah. And so I feel like that's something that they're probably toying with over there, and they're seeing how that works. And then probably the things that do work and don't work, they'll take over to Star Wars. So I don't think it's going to be an open ending, even the way that, you know, the last two trilogies have ended. I don't think they would end on I'm your father and then be like, we don't know if we're coming back again.
Now think in terms of TV, right?
Yeah.
Look at Dexter, for example, right? I think it was season three. Season three ends, he kills John Lithgow.
Four.
Spoiler.
That was four.
Was that season four? Yeah. Oh, you're right. Because season three was Jimmy Smith's, if I'm not mistaken. Yes. So four, he kills Jonathan Lithgow. They closed the story.
Mm-hmm.
But next year, the next story begins. So you don't need to have an open end to move into the next. You close off one trilogy and the next one starts in 2 years with the new threat or the new drama or the new whatever comes into the lives of our heroes. Maybe it's a new set of heroes. Maybe it's probably the same set of heroes with the new characters added. They don't need to leave it open ended in order to start the steps for episode 10.
Okay, what's next?
Our next question is from Mike Vetter. After Rebels is done, do you think Filoni should make an animated series that takes place between episode 6 and 7?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
100%. And you're gonna agree with me when I explain.
Okay. Oh gosh.
It depends. Look, there's two things here, because I want to. It also depends on what's gonna happen with the novels and what happens in the canon leading up to the end of Rebels. There's a lot of stuff that can happen in between then. But yeah, I'd like to see what's going to happen, what happened between those times. Because Shattered Empire, to me, I loved. And it ended after like four. And I was like, more. I'd also like to see an animated series that maybe happened right before episode 7. Doesn't necessarily happen in between 6 and 7, but maybe before episode 7 or in the time period that we're in now.
Would you want to see something like Lost Stars turned into an animated series?
No, because this is the tricky part.
Because you know the story?
Yes, and it's the tricky part with canon is because they've told me the story already too, and then if they have to take those characters and do some more stuff with them in a story that I already knew, and then you have to retcon some stuff. It gets tricky with this, the way new canon works. So probably not. Why do you
get your sneakers ready? You're about to jump on my bed. All right. So reading the question as it's written, okay, after Rebels is done, do you think Filoni should make an animated series that takes between 6 and 7? I'll say, look, that's a huge time period.
Yeah.
Massive time period. Yeah, you can do anime
series.
No, Dave Filoni should not be doing an anime series.
He should be directing an anthology.
He should be directing an anthology movie. That's what he should be doing next.
I'm not going to argue with that, but I'm saying if he doesn't get the anthology film.
Okay, yeah, if he doesn't get the anthology film, sure.
Yes.
But you asked me what should Filoni be doing next, he should be directing one of the anthology films.
If the question is, would I rather see him do a film, a Star Wars film, or would I rather see him do another animated series, I want to see him do anthology.
I would like to see him do the live action TV series.
Yeah.
I think that he knows how to tell a story over episodes. So I think that having someone like that who knows the Star Wars world so much and could do new characters that maybe we don't have as much of a connection to, which I think we saw a lot of in Rebels, not quite as much as I think we would on a TV series. Mm-hmm. But I think sometimes if you have somebody who's great at episodic, keep them in episodic. I think he would be fantastic for the TV series.
I do too. Okay, what's next?
Our next one is from R. Antares. Forget young Han. Who would you cast as young Lando? He says Kenyon Lonsdale is my vote.
I'm not familiar.
Kenyon plays Wally West on The Flash.
Okay, I need to watch a little bit more of The Flash. But I will tell you that my two picks, the easy is Michael B. Jordan. He's been rumored for Star Wars for a very long time. Even in Josh Trank's movie, they were saying he was supposed to be in it. But for my number one pick is Nate Parker. I think Nate Parker for me would be, again, I've been singing his
you
praises
just love
forever.
Nate Parker.
I love Nate Parker. I think he's one of the best actors out there and underrated. And I think that once Birth of a Nation comes out, more people are going to know who he is.
What age are we looking at, though?
For a young, I don't know. Depends on when it comes out.
It could be anywhere from 14 to 26 27.
Who knows? But I mean, I don't think you're ever going to have. Maybe you will, but I don't know if they're going to do a young Lando movie.
Mm-hmm.
But I think a young Lando, it would be great for Lando. I want to see young Lando pop up. I want to see that scene where he lost the the Falcon to Lando. That'd be great. And and I think you need a really great actor, and I think those are the two guys. Do you have any choices? Who you think?
Chadwick Boseman.
Chadwick Boseman. Yeah.
Chadwick Boseman. I've seen him pull off that swagger that you'd want associated with Lando Calrissian.
James Brown, baby.
Oh, exactly. Yeah. Yes, actually, as a matter of fact, that's a great illustration of that. I think Chadwick Boseman would make a great.
Yeah, I agree.
As far as the, you know, I'm on the Flash recap show. That dude playing Wally West right now has not impressed anybody yet.
Yeah.
So I'm for Chadwick Boseman. What about you?
I actually, within the DC world, I like the kid who's playing Firestorm now on Legends of Tomorrow.
He's growing on me.
Again, new kid, haven't really seen him do a lot, but I think he has the like sweet side of him, but also that edge that Lando has that I think would be really fun to play with.
Okay.
But I think Nate Parker, if you're going a bit older, like, but that guy's kid's a little bit younger, so it just depends on what age they go to.
All right, what's next?
Hold on one second. Our next one is from Jason Jansen, who says, saw YouTube describing Benicio del Toro as Ezra turned to the dark side in episode 8. Age is correct. Thoughts?
This has been going around a lot, and I get tweets about it. Five or six times a day about this theory. Do they match up? Actually, Benicio's actually a little younger than Ezra, because Ezra would be Luke's age, and I think Benicio's only like 48 or 49, something like that. But you could also play him older, and it's not that big of a deal. Do I think he's going to play Ezra? No, I don't. I kind of go with John on this, to where I don't think they're going to take an animated character and make him that big of a story. I don't know, that big of a reveal in episode 8.
We also don't know how big of a story Benicio is going to have in episode 8.
I think you don't bring in Benicio del Toro to be subpar.
Did it with Guardians. I mean, they did it with Marvel having him be the collector.
It's true, they did, but I think this is a little different. I think that he's coming out like a villain, and I think he's going to be, whether or not he's a Knight of Ren or someone bigger or bounty hunter, it's going to be something big, but I don't think he's Ezra.
The ages aren't as far off as you might think, because there's 30 years. They're saying roughly 30 years from the end of from the end of Jedi to The Force Awakens. Add on another 5 years from
Luke's age.
From Star Wars. Benicio's pushing 50. He's getting close to 50.
But 10 years off, and you can play that.
So yeah, you could play that. It's still not true.
Right.
They're not going to do that. You're not going to see Ezra. Something very bad happens to Ezra before Star Wars Episode 4, New Hope. Yeah. Something very bad happens to him.
Do you think any chance?
I don't think it's him. I could see it where people, you know, is there a similarity that you could be like, oh, he's an older version of him? Absolutely. But I do actually think they're going to bring characters over from
maybe in Rogue
the animated
One.
Into the film universe. I just don't know if it's going to be Ezra yet. Yeah.
Okay. All right, let's do two more.
Our next one is from Jay Espinosa. Has it been announced if Tarkin is a character in the new Rogue One movie? And if so, who would play him?
It's been rumored. And the rumor was that you were going to have Peter Cushing actually as a hologram.
Yep.
The thing was, when that happened.
Oh, that was when they were talking about shooting stuff like, never mind.
When it was announced, John and I were on the same page, and we lost our minds at how silly it would have been to do that. Why not just put, you know, Ben Mendelsohn as Tarkin if you're going to do it? But then someone had said something to me, and I was like, well, you know what? That could make sense. You could do something to where if you just made him, you know, it had pop in like as messaging the same way the Emperor came in to talk to
Vader.
So if
he's not really in the movie.
He's not really in the movie, but Vader speaking with him over the same way he was to the Emperor, I'd be down for that if they can make it work.
Sure. Yeah. If it's nothing but a hologram projection of him from one ship talking to Vader, you do that. But then he's not really in the movie. Like if you're talking about a legit.
But the character would be.
Sure. But if you're talking about a legit character in the film, like has a presence in the film and is there doing things, then no. If he's just doing like cameo spots over hologram, that's a different ballgame altogether.
Snoke had a presence in the film, but it was just off of that hologram. Well, he
Who
wasn't
did?
Really
Snoke
in Force Awakens. He wasn't really there.
That's true, but he had like long scenes with lots of dialogue. Right. Well, and
now the thing is, are you opposed to Tarkin being in the movie or just them using
Tarkin fits? He's like Bail Organa, whatever.
Yeah. Okay.
He's overseeing the construction of the Death Star. It would be odd for him not to be there.
Right. Okay, I'm with you. Actually, you know, let's do two more. All right. Forget there's two left.
There's just two left. Yeah. Our next one is from Ethan Naftalin. Sorry if I pronounced your last name wrong. Do you guys think it was a wasted opportunity that there was no Rogue One trailer at the Super Bowl?
I don't think it was a wasted opportunity. I was upset. A wasted opportunity? No, because they needed to get Jungle Book out there. They did. They needed to get Civil War out there. They did. I think that it would be a wasted opportunity if they don't show something before Civil War. I think it's another way, because that was going to be one of the most profitable movies, or even before Jungle Book. It's going to be one of the more profitable movies of the summer, Civil War, that is. To show Rogue One and to let people know that not only is it a Star Wars movie, but Darth Vader is going to be in this movie. I think it's a good marketing tool to do that, and I think they'll talk about it at both Celebration and Comic-Con. So, no, I don't think it was a wasted opportunity, Tiff.
I don't think it was a wasted opportunity at all. I actually think that they did not need to put it during the Super Bowl, because when you look at how much it costs to put those ads during the game, and even, you know, Civil War for me, that it was so early, I almost wasn't even ready for that trailer, where it was just like, it was before the game even started.
Yeah.
And I'm sure there is some difference with paying for that spot versus a spot right in the middle of the game versus a spot at the end. And I don't think they really need to build it just yet. And I think that they have way more opportunities coming up where, like you said, with Civil War. And I think Jungle Book did what it needed to do with that spot. So am I like fangirl disappointed that I didn't get to see Rogue One stuff? A little bit, but I'm like, okay, I'm going to get to see it and it's going to be at the right time.
John?
It was absolutely a missed opportunity.
You think so?
Absolutely missed opportunity. Absolutely. You had the third largest viewed program in the history of broadcast television. Was that to get out in front, because there's still people who are going to be a little bit confused about what's going on, to get out in front of that audience and to plant your flag now, because you put out the first teaser for the original Star Wars Episode 7 even sooner than this would be in relation to that. Now, but it's a different question to ask, okay, was it a missed opportunity and will this really bite them in the ass that they didn't do it? No, it's not going to really bite them. They'll be fine. They will. But it was an opportunity that was squandered, and I thought they could have taken advantage of it.
I understand that point. All right, last one.
From Zach, or Mr. J831. Think for sure if Boba Fett is in Rogue One, we see why Vader said no disintegrations.
I sure hope so, man. What a great question was. The second I got that question, I started thinking about it, and I'm like, I hope so. That would tie in the original trilogy so well. And everybody's always wondered, what the hell did he do? They haven't done it in a book yet. They haven't done it in a comic. So why not save it for Rogue One? How great. And there's been rumors that Boba Fett will be in it. It'll be great if you see, because we know that anyway, after Episode 4, that Vader uses Boba Fett a lot in the comics.
Yeah.
We know that he uses him in Empire. It would be great to see this. I hope.
It would not just be great to see him do it once, but to see him do it two or three times.
Yeah, right.
And each time,
and Vader's like, cut
no
it out.
Disintegrations.
Yeah, right.
And he does it again. I think it would be great. This is a fabulous
question.
I hope they do it.
Yeah, I definitely hope they do. I think it's one of those things where it would be great fan service because a lot of people would catch on to it, and I think a lot of people would also miss it. But the people who caught on to it would be like, oh my God, this is so cool, because it's an explanation for something that obviously when it was written before, it's like, yeah, there's a story behind this. So what's the story?
It's also a nice way to tie in younger audiences.
Yep.
So if there was some kid maybe who goes and sees Rogue One, maybe before he even sees Episode 5, because Rogue One could serve to a lot of people, you know, once, and you don't really think about this. Because of the events that happened, you could watch Rogue One. Hopefully it's a good movie, but you could watch that first and then watch Episode 4, 5, and 6. Rogue One could be the first movie that you ever watch as a Star Wars fan. Who knows? It might be the perfect way in the timeline if it works, as long as they don't give away any reveals. But that would be a great thing for a kid that sees it for the first time and then runs into Empire Strikes Back and goes, oh, yeah, I know why he said that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, or like, ha-ha, no disintegrated. Remember when he did that? Remember when he
destroyed? Yeah, yeah. Remember, yeah, exactly. Diego Luna got disintegrated. Okay, that's it. That's our show. I wanted to thank you guys for tuning in once again. Make sure that you comment any of the stories that we talked about today that you want to chime in on. Make sure you do that. Use the comment section. Have a conversation about Star Wars. That is why we're here. Obviously, on Twitter, Let's Talk Star Wars. The three, the four of us. Anybody you want to talk to about Star Wars, you should be hitting us up and let's talk some Star Wars. I'd like to thank the council. First, the Smith Lord. Where can they find you?
You guys can find me on social media at Tiffany's Tweets, Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat. And then obviously you can always find me doing stuff on Fandango movie clips. This week specifically, there's a lot of stuff with Deadpool. I got to interview Ryan Reynolds and TJ Miller, so check out Weekend Ticket over there. And then I've got DC All Access going on as well. New episodes up every day. So.
And he is Obi-John Kenobi, John Campia. Where can they find you?
You guys can find me on social media, on Facebook and on Twitter, simply at John Campia. Make sure you check out, if you're watching this on Thursday, make sure you check out our movie talk episode that we did earlier today. We actually had the screenwriters for Deadpool in studio here with us, and they were just wonderful. They were awesome. And they were fantastic. And really, really soon, I'm announcing the release date for my book, The Pride. Make sure you stay on top. Follow me on social media. I will keep you up to date when the release date is announced, and it's imminent.
And speaking of Deadpool, make sure that you check out our spoiler-heavy review of Deadpool, which will be up tomorrow on this channel. So make sure you check that out. And make sure that you hashtag Collider Jedi Council so we can get some of your questions on the air. And follow me at Christian Harloff on Twitter and Instagram and the Periscope. Why not tonight? And that's it. That's all we got. So join us next week. We'll be back. May the Force be with you. Always.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.